Jack Benny kept us laughing for over 60 years in a career that took him from vaudeville violinist to celebrated radio comedian to the most beloved entertainer in America. Always acknowledging that the joke was on him, he created the most enduring persona in American humor. Stingy, vain, and exasperated by almost everything, Jack's impeccable timing and scratchy violin kept him 39 forever.
There are very few people left anymore who played vaudeville, motion pictures, radio, television, nightclubs, and been successful in all of them.
On his show, he played a cheap man, you know? And in real life, he was one of the most generous men you've ever known.
People just fell in love with him, and they never fell out of love with him.
In life, he was a constant friend, generous philanthropist, and devoted musician.
There is nobody today like Jack Benny.
He was a quiet riot.
Jack Benny offered us a tender vision of ourselves. We loved what we saw.
About you. I work like a dog on big, wonderful joke routines to get one little laugh, and all you do is fold your hands and say, well. And you stare at them for 2 minutes while they get hysterical. What's so funny about wow?
You have to know how to phrase it.
Phrase what? It's only got one syllable.
Now, the reason my character sustained over so many years, like you say, how could things go on and on? Well, because I played a character that included all the faults and the frailties. I think that's the right word, and the frailties of mankind. See, every family had somebody like me. Either they had an uncle who was stingy, or one who thought he was very sexy and he wasn't. So every family has that kind of a person.
The character was so strong that people to this day who didn't know him believe that persona. That persona was created by his writers over a period of years all through radio. The stinginess, the vanity, the so-called vanity, the blue eyes, him taking offense. That character was so strong that when Jack would go out in public, he would usually overtip.
There were a few jokes written about my being stingy. And people laughed at it, at the jokes. So we put in a couple more the next week, and then maybe we cut them out for a week or two. And we put some more in. And all of a sudden, I was stingy against my will. I like the characterization of being stingy because I think it is the easiest to get laughs with.
Jack.
Well, I don't know. Let's see. Grenadina beef, $3.75. Long Island duckling, $4.50. Filet mignon. Whoops! Oh, brother.
If you don't mind, I'll take the orders.
All right, I'll have grenadina beef.
Thank you. You, madame?
I'll have the Long Island duckling.
Thank you, madame. You, sir?
I'll have the hoops medium rare.
By the 40s, maybe even earlier, the audience was conditioned. They were like Pavlov's dog. If you mentioned money, they laughed. If you mentioned cheap, they laughed. You didn't have to tell a joke. You only had to mention the word.
Well, if you feel that way, why don't you take the job in the first place?
I've asked myself that 1,000 times, and I always come up with the same answer.
Money.
Yes.
Mister, keep those hands up. Now, come on. Your money or your life? I said, your money or your life.
I'm thinking it over.
Jack's persona was an endless running gag, and the more time we spent with him, the funnier it became.
And little by little, he built up this character. The character of a thrift, egotistical, man who thought he was a ladies' man.
Marilyn, why did you walk away from me? Why did you want to leave me?
Because I can't trust myself with you.
What?
You're so strong and I'm so weak. And when you look at me with those big blue eyes, I just...
I understand.
Well, you know why I keep saying that I'm 39?
Huh.
Well, because I know I don't look my right age.
You know you don't? That's very true.
I really don't.
That's very true. You want to?
I don't look 39 either. Right?
Mister.
Yeah. Say, you're Jack Benny, aren't you?
Yes.
Your age. Hey, do you mind if I check your physical condition?
Oh, no, not at all.
Is that your muscle, or are you still plugging Jell-O?
Never mind the jokes. Just guess my age.
You haven't paid me yet.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. You're 39.
Yeah. Say, what made you say I was 39?
Well, I've got your quarter. Let's both be happy.
Central to the mechanics of his comedy was Jack's trademark, the violin.
Play, please.
Major Vista, little liar. Play it softly while you're learning. Not so loud, my stomach's turning.
To Tommy from Jack Benny.
You know, Mr. Benny, I play the violin, too.
Oh, really?
I've been playing for 2 years.
Oh, well, how well do you play?
Pretty good.
That's wonderful. You play like me?
I used to.
Jack Benny was the greatest reactor in comedy, I think, that ever was, that we ever had, or I don't know of any today who can top him. And by that, he could let all the craziness happen around him that would be funny in itself, and then all he would do would be to react to it, and he never did much more than just give a very contained look. Or he might bring his hand up to his cheek, and that would be the topper of the whole thing.
Sasha, will you open this bottle of champagne, please?
Open it yourself. I'm sick of bubbles.
He could pause when somebody would say something that would get a laugh. Jack would pause, and the audience would start to laugh. And he had the courage to keep pausing, to not try to fill that silence, because the more he would drag it out, the funnier it became, until it was just, it was side-splitting.
His timing was exquisite. And where other people use words, Jack would use silence.
Do you remember your first laugh on a stage?
Well,
That's the silliest question. I've been in show business probably 60 years.
Oh, my God. Have you?
And you're asking me if I can remember the first laugh.
Well, I would think
so. I can't remember the last laugh.
Jack was born Benjamin Kubelski on Valentine's Day, February 14th, 1894, in Waukegan, Illinois. His mother dreamed of young Benny being a concert violinist and presented him with a $50 violin for his sixth birthday. After dropping out of school, Jack began his career in the pit orchestra of a local theater.
When I first went into vaudeville, I was just about 17 years old. And I was a violinist, and I couldn't talk at all on the stage. If I'd have said, thank you, I think I would have fainted, you know? And then I had to give it up, and I joined the Navy in the First World War, and I was in a sailor show. And I was supposed to do a violin and piano duet with Zez Confrey, you know who he is. So the next day we go to rehearsal, he gives me more. Suddenly the show opens and I've got the comedy part of the show. So I kept grabbing the violin and talking until finally I played the Palace.
During his days as a vaudeville headliner, Jack met the man who would remain his closest friend for the rest of his life.
Jack and I, we were friends for 55 years. And there was a reason why we were friends. I always told Jack he was a great violinist, and he always told me I was a great singer. That's why we stayed friends. We never lied to each other. But who taught him everything he knows? I taught him everything he knows. Jack had an act. It wasn't so hot. The act needed something. He didn't know what. I said, Jack, if you want to pull him in, go get yourself a violin. You can kill the people and fill up the room. Play some corny melody like Love and Bloom. Tell me, have you ever seen him take this pose? Well.
Yeah, that's my favorite pose.
That was mine. I taught him everything from what to say to fiddling. I taught him everything he knows.
I really don't understand. What do you mean that George Burns isn't that great?
Well, you see, Tommy, nobody does it alone. Yeah. I taught George everything he knows. I remember the first time I saw him work. I was just a kid. He smoked a pipe in his act and bombed. It was awful. I went up to him and I said, Mr. Burns? And he said, yes, kid. And I said, get rid of that pipe and put a cigar in the act. Well, he did it, and the rest is history. It even brought his voice down 2 octaves. I never can make George Burns laugh. Never. He never laughs at me. And I laugh at him all the time. It drives me crazy.
George Burns killed him, you know. He'd kill him with any kind, anything that George Burns said, he'd laugh at, because George Burns was, again, I say, he was brash with him. And George would hold his lapel up and say, George, see this? He says, what? He said, nothing's happened to it yet. Nutty stuff like that. And Jack would fall on the ground.
We had a party one night, and he had a little white thread on his lapel. I said, I didn't know they were wearing that this season. You might never borrow it. I took the little white thread off his lapel. I put on my lapel. It's not the funniest bit in the world. I'm sure Milton Berle is not going to steal it. Anyway, he not only laughed, but he fell down on the floor 3 times. The next day, I took the thread, put it in a little box, and sent it to his house and said, thanks for letting me wear this last night. I got a call from Mary Benny. She says, the thread got here an hour ago, and Jack is still on the floor laughing. As soon as he stops laughing, I think I'll leave him.
In 1927, Jack married Sadie Marks, who later took the name of a radio personality, Mary Livingston.
You know, you always hear these things about Hollywood. Divorces right away. Some people stay married. I've been married to Mary 38 years.
Sure.
I love Mary. You know, I really do. I wouldn't give up Mary for Elizabeth Taylor or Richard Burton.
You want to know something? I wouldn't.
In 1933, Jack and Mary were thrilled to welcome their daughter Joan into the family.
We moved to Los Angeles in 1935. I was just a baby. A lot of the radio people were moving to Los Angeles. I mean, the movie people had already moved to Los Angeles. Hollywood was the center. And so it was a big source of having guests on your program. They were now building big radio studios in Hollywood, and it became the center of show business, other than, of course, the stage.
By the 1930s, radio had become the most popular entertainment medium in the world. Like Amos and Andy, Eddie Cantor, and Ed Wynn before him, radio would make Jack Benny a household name.
My earliest recollection of Jack was listening to him on the radio when I was a kid. When he would say Jell-O again, Jell-O was his sponsor, I remember. I'd do my homework and listen to Jack.
The Lucky Strike program starring Jack Benny with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Rochester Dennis Day, and yours truly, Don Wilson.
From 1932 to 1955, an unforgettable family of recurring characters would create a comedic world tailor-made to Jack's persona.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, from Camp Hahn, California, we bring you a man who pedaled here all the way from Hollywood on the rear end of a tandem bicycle, Jack Benny!
And now, folks, this novel quiz program will go on immediately after... Pardon me, I'll take it. Hello?
Hello, Mr. Benny, this is Rochester.
Rochester played my butler, my valet, my chauffeur, who had a right to insult me. Because I was the kind of a fella that was the cause of it.
You mean to say you lost my bicycle shooting craps?
Well, I was lucky for the first three passes.
Lucky, and then what happened?
My dice went into a minuet and my opponent became suspicious.
Mary always sort of ran my life, even though she wasn't supposedly married to me.
Well, who drove the bus, Phil? I mean, who drove the bus, Phil?
No, I did. Phil was up on the roof taking a sun bath.
All right, so I made a mistake.
We made Phil Harris a sort of a smart alecky guy. He either left a pool room or a bar or a girl.
When your boys were inside that bus rehearsing, why weren't you down there with them?
Look, Jackson, I just stand in front of them and shake a stick. When they're through, I stop.
Oh.
Unless I had a bad night.
When Dennis came in, you knew he was always vague about something.
It was so windy coming down here, I could hardly catch my breath.
Oh, it wasn't so windy.
Don't tell me. I was sitting on the handlebars.
What of it? You had a nice soft cushion under you.
Some cushion. Every time Rochester rang the bell, I darn near wiggled off.
The Jack Benny Show was like... it was like a world of people. There were so many different people, and we didn't use them all on one show or the next show.
The reason Jack was successful, he'd get a great routine. He'd use it maybe every 3 months.
By 1936, Jack Benny was the number one comedian in the country. The writers of the Benny program continued to break new ground for radio.
Their whole show was based on situations rather than just jokes. I'm sure the writers who wrote for the Benny Show would sit down every week and say, we've got this marvelous cast of characters. All we have to do is write this situation, put these characters in it, and it'll work.
He treated his writers with respect. That's a pretty good reason of why they were with him so long. That and the fact that he paid very good wages.
Jack would come in the room, sit at the end of the table, get out a cigar, pick up the script for the first time. He was a great study, and he'd go word by word. He'd say, should we say we're going instead of we are going? And he was a perfectionist, and this way we got very good results.
We had no guidelines. Most shows do have a guideline. Didn't have it. If Jack felt comfortable, we wouldn't even suggest anything off color, because we knew he wouldn't feel comfortable. And we weren't built that way.
Jack understood that we were listening to him in the privacy of our homes, not in a theater. And because the show was about his life, he made us feel that we were his intimate friends.
People say he started situation comedy. It wasn't situation comedy in the true sense. It was something that could have happened to the real Jack Benny.
It wasn't part of a sitcom setup with a beginning and a middle and an end and all that. It was just a like a vignette scene from Jack's daily life.
He surrounded himself with good people. I'm speaking now, that would include the writers, but I'm talking now about the performing cast, the supporting cast. They were all good people. They knew their business. And when they came on the Benny Show, you didn't have to worry about them. You gave them their part, gave them a little brief instruction. They did it.
He would have to go to the studio, I think about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and Sunday mornings was our time together. And we would get in the car, and he had a convertible, and we would drive to Malibu for breakfast. And he would tell me, he treated me like a person. I mean, he would tell me what the show was going to be about, who the guest star would be, did I think it was a funny idea, and he would go over it with me, and I felt like I was a part of it. And he made me feel very special.
You didn't forget your broadcast, did you?
How could I forget? The broadcast, always the broadcast, year after year. Every Monday, I think of ideas. Tuesday, I meet with my writers. Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, we write. Saturday, I rehearse. And on Sunday, I do my program, and one short half hour, it's all over. All that work for just one half hour. And for what, I ask you? For what?
For a lousy $1 million.
From Television City in Hollywood, we bring you the Jack Benny Program.
On October 28, 1950, the first Jack Benny program on television was broadcast live.
I'd give $1 million to know how I look. Dinah, Remember that first show we did in New York?
Oh, do I ever. We were both nervous wrecks.
Right.
In fact, we were so nervous right after the show, we went over to Sardi's, and we had a couple of drinks, and we relaxed.
Yeah. And you remember what happened? We were too young, and they wouldn't serve us any alcohol. It seems that I don't know, all week we've been here rehearsing, you know, and I don't know, I never got to see you at all this week. You'd come in the theater alone, and you'd leave alone. And I was just wondering that if tonight, now that the excitement of the first show is over, I was wondering if you mind maybe if we went out together and I'd take you home afterwards, you know?
Oh, Jack, I can't see any harm in that.
Oh, I wish you could.
I don't think there was a moment's disappointment. I think it was, you know, it was, he was just a total charge. I think his program was probably in the top 10 for as long as he wanted it to be.
With the show now on television, we could finally see those characters who had lived so long in our imaginations.
I was just telling all the folks out there that you have been with me 17 of my 19 years in radio.
Well, thanks, Jack, and I must say those 17 years have been very happy ones.
Well, thank you, Don.
Not fruitful, but happy.
Now, look, Mary, you called me, you rushed over in a cab. Now, what is it you want to say to me?
Well, Jack.
Uh-huh.
Jack, something has got to be done about your being so cheap.
What's bothering you?
Well, I'll tell you what's bothering me. The last time you used me was on the opening show of the season. That was 5 months ago, and you haven't used me since.
Well, Dennis, there's a reason for that. After all, you know how the way my shows are constructed. It's only a half hour, and I have to make everything tie in. Have you fit into the show?
Oh, sure. Excuses. I wouldn't mind if I hadn't been with you for so many years. If I haven't grown to admire you as a performer and developed such a deep sense of loyalty and devotion.
Well, I appreciate your loyalty, but... Well, now, take the last program that I did 2 weeks ago. How would you fit in there?
I don't know. I didn't see it.
Hello? Must have hung up. I wonder who... Rochester!
Oh, hello, boss.
You've been sitting here all the time?
Uh-huh.
With the phone. Didn't you hear the phone?
Uh-huh.
Well, why didn't you answer it?
This is my day off.
The versatile Mel Blanc provided a host of memorable characters.
One of his favorite routines was the C-Psy routine, which I did with Jack for... We started in radio, and it went through television. And this is... we only had about 10 words of dialogue in the entire script. And it was very well received. It was a very popular thing.
Pardon me, mister, but did that man over there put some of my clothes in your luggage?
Si.
Well, are you going to Mexico City?
Si.
Are you taking flight 18?
Si.
What's your name?
Si.
Si?
Si.
I understand you're going to visit your sister.
Si.
I'm afraid to ask this next one. What's her name?
Su.
Su?
Si.
On television, Jack's trademark visual mannerisms added a whole new dimension to his comedy.
I don't know, your dialogue was always so sparkling and witty and original and everything. I wish my writers could be that funny. You use writers?
There could be all kinds of comedians doing shtick around him, and then Jack would just do this, and it would be the button for the whole bit.
If I were directing your show, there are certainly a lot of changes I'd like to make.
Like what, for instance? What you...
Well, for one thing, I think I'd bring out right through the middle of the curtain here and eliminate that long walk of yours.
Walk?
Yeah.
Well, what's wrong?
Well, there's nothing wrong with it. It's just that you've been doing it for so many years, other stars have started to copy you.
Other stars copy my walk? Who, for instance?
Well, there's Loretta Young.
They make a mistake. They always say I walk like this. No, I don't walk like this. You know, they always do this.
Of course not.
I walk like this.
They always get the wrong answer.
Bob Hope walks like that.
Yes.
Yeah, Bob does one of those walks, too. Jack, it's such
a thrill.
Well,
he's effeminate.
Such
anyway.
A thrill.
Of all people to say that about, that didn't fit at all.
No, that's terrible.
Yeah.
Now, Rich, cut that out.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
Oh, shut up.
Jack.
The focus of the television show gradually shifted away from the radio family, but the style remained the same. Jack just couldn't win.
Jack told me once, and I've never forgotten it. He said, you got to remember when you do a show, it's not important who gets the laugh within the show. He said, people the next day will say, gee, the Jack Benny show was funny. So he taught me that if you have somebody on a show, you give the guest the best line or you let them be funny, the people will say the next day, gee, the Benny show was funny.
Bob, look, you know, if you had come to my dressing room when you were supposed to, before you'd know that you weren't supposed to walk out here until I introduced you.
Jack, I tried to get to your dressing room. I started down the hallway, but some people grabbed me, and I couldn't get away from them. They wanted to know how a comedian works, how he commands the attention of the audience, and how he gets big laughs.
Oh, tourists, huh?
No, your producer, director, and your writer.
I say you should do a television show every week.
I should?
Sure.
but I think you should do a comedy show.
Comedy show?
Yeah, I think you should start being real funny, Jack.
Well, what have I been doing all these years?
I don't know, it couldn't have been a comedy show that you've been doing in 30 years, because in 30 years I haven't stolen a joke from you.
You couldn't steal from Jack Benny. You can steal from Milton Berle. That may not be a good analogy. You can steal from any young man. You can steal jokes from comedians. You can't steal from Jack. Because when Jack walked on the stage and would do a joke about, you know, I just finished a television special, he says, to me a special is when coffee goes from $1.29 to 79 cents a pound. Nobody else could steal that joke because it didn't mean anything else with anybody else doing it.
Jack's subtle style, however, could be borrowed.
In all of the years that I've known Johnny Carson, he has never failed to identify his regard for Jack Benny as a person, but also to admit that many, many of the pauses and looks and hand gestures that Johnny uses, he didn't steal from Jack, but he used them because through admiration and because they worked.
Well, I guess I'm ready. Goodbye, Mother. Goodbye, Dad.
Goodbye?
Yeah, Jackie, what's this all about? Well, I'll tell you what it's all about. I'm 21 and I'm leaving.
21. He's 33 if he's a day. What do you mean you're leaving?
Well, I'm sick of this carnival. You know, I don't have to do this. I'm gonna change my name and be a comedian. Tell jokes on television. That's where all the money is.
Money, money. There are more important things than money.
If you weren't my father, I'd slap your face.
My father was a great appreciator, is that a word, of talent. He loved to help young talent.
Mr. George Burns discovered me and gave me my big break in show business and took me with him in his review at the Sahara Hotel in Las Vegas many, many, many years ago. It was there that I met Jack Benny. And he happened to be there every single night in the wings, and we would talk. And I remember one night before the show, Jack Benny asked me if I wanted to be on his television program, and I said, sure, I'd love to.
Well, as I said, I come from Wilmette, Illinois, and I was born in the trunk.
Oh, you were born in a trunk. You mean your folks were in show business, huh?
No, luggage.
Aren't you ashamed of yourself? Well, that was a joke, though, wasn't it?
Well, yeah.
Well, it was pretty good. That was a pretty good... Who gave it to you?
George Burns.
I think probably the first television appearance I did do after I left Gary's show was for Jack. It was exciting to come out to California and be a guest with Jack Benny. We did Tarzan and Jane 20 years after they'd married, so Jack came swinging in on a swing.
Believe that's King of the Jungle.
There was a moment where we had to, he wanted to play ball. Tarzan wanted to play ball with Jane and wanted to toss boulders back and forth at each other. So I picked up this huge boulder, which of course was light, and I threw it at Jack, and Jack fell back, and there were these fake bushes that he fell into, and he caught his finger on something that was sticking out. He was bleeding, and he really hurt himself. If you see the show today, he kind of looks down at his hand and he hides it through the next 4 or 5 minutes of his scene. He was trained in theater, He was trained to not stop for anything. The sketch was going well. He wasn't going to, and we had an audience there. He wasn't going to upset people and say, well, gee, I need a Band-Aid or, you know, give me some peroxide on this. He just kept on going.
He was very generous, and he told me, I know that the Hit Parade is looking to replace one of their singers. So I said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you the greatest audition anybody ever had. And with this, he had me as his special guest on his show. And I wasn't well known at that time. He gave me everything. He gave me all the funny lines. He let me play the piano. He let me sing. He took me down to his vault.
As many years as I've had that vault, no one has ever been permitted to go down there with me. I'm terribly sorry, but
oh, Jack, please, please take me down. I'd love to see you. I wouldn't tell anybody. I wouldn't tell anybody.
Well, I'll tell you what. All right. But remember, you're the first one that has ever seen my ball.
And then at the end, he had me play the violin.
You're a nice fiddle you got there, Jack.
Well, he couldn't do any more than that. And the very next day, the Hit Parade people called and said, we want you. And that was the beginning of a happy, happy time for me. Thanks to Jack Benny.
I was on his television show, actually, I think twice. It may have been more, but I remember specifically two shows. One where the idea was my father dreamed he was married to Mary Livingston, who, of course, was my mother, and that they had a teenage daughter. And guess who got the role?
Oh, hello, Johnny. Oh, hi, Mother. So busy doing my homework, I didn't hear you come in.
Well, that's funny. Or Johnny finished with your homework by this time.
I know, but I'm doing it over. I never should have asked Daddy to help me. Look, he did some of my math problems, and every answer came out 39.
Well, that's a number that's stuck in his head.
I think anybody who ever worked with him knows he cared enormously about the show and knew what he was doing probably as well or better than anybody I've ever worked with.
I want to tell you how very, very happy I am that last week I was nominated for one of the Emmy Awards this year. You see, of course, I was nominated 3 years ago and 2 years ago, and I was nominated last year. You see, and naturally, all these nominations always make me very excited and enthusiastic, and yet I have never actually won the award, you see. That's like a tennis player jumping over the net and then finding out he lost the match.
Jack Benny was a television fixture for 24 years.
The winner in Hollywood is Jack Benny.
Adored by audiences and critics alike, The Jack Benny Show ultimately won a total of 8 Emmy Awards.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks again very, very much. And also, wouldn't it be funny if my next show was lousy?
Though he made movies throughout his career, Jack would never achieve the same stardom on the silver screen he enjoyed on radio and in television. In his films of the 30s and early 40s, Jack played variations of his familiar radio character.
Well, aren't you ashamed of yourself?
But, officer, there's been a misunderstanding. Look, I'm Jack Benny.
Jack Benny? The radio comedian?
Yes. Yes. Do you listen to my program?
Oh, I never miss them.
Well, I'm glad. Gee, that's swell. Come over and see us next Sunday. Here's a ticket for you.
Oh, gosh, thanks. Well, you come over and see us next Monday. Here's a ticket for you.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Hey!
He was a marvelous actor. His movie that he made, I think, with Lubitsch, To Be or Not to Be, if you go look at that movie, you find that he was a fine comedy actor.
It was a wonderful picture. The picture today is a cult picture.
In his finest film, Jack plays a world-renowned actor in Nazi-occupied Poland.
To be or not to be? That is the question. It happened. What every actor dreads.
What, darling? What?
Someone walked out on me. Tell me, Maria, am I losing my grip?
Oh, of course not, darling. I'm so sorry.
But he walked out on me.
Oh, maybe he didn't feel well. Maybe he had to leave. Maybe he had a sudden heart attack.
I hope so.
If he stayed, he might have died.
Maybe he's dead already. Oh, darling, you're so comforting.
Jack was bigger than the movies he did. In other words, you know, Jack wasn't stingy. That was just a character. But every time you'd see him on the screen, if he wasn't stingy, they didn't believe him. He was bigger than the movies.
The last picture he did was at Warner Brothers called The Hornblowers at Midnight. It was a picture where Jack played an angel who came down from heaven on a mission.
Not a bad little planet at that. I know it has a name.
Oh, that's the planet Earth, sir.
Oh, yes. Created rather hurriedly, as I recall.
Just a 6-day job, wasn't it?
Practically slapped together, you might say. We'll take a good look at it because we're going to slap it apart.
We are?
Yes. Orders from the front office. Usually when a planet goes berserk, it's our demolition expert who descends, blows his horn, and poof.
Poof?
Hmm. Just now, however, our demolition expert is disposing of one of the larger planets. So for this bit of destruction, I'm using you.
Me?
Yes, as the angel least likely to be missed.
Hornblowers at Midnight was a required viewing, and that was just about as bad as they said it was.
You know, I made a picture once. The horn blows at midnight. And I believe if that had been made in CinemaScope, it would have been a huge success.
Well, you know, CinemaScope is very complicated. Mm-hmm. In order to put the big screen in all the theaters, they have to take out a lot of seats.
Mm-hmm. Well, in my picture, they could have taken out all of the seats.
For those of us who knew him offstage, the real Jack Benny was a gentle man who loved to laugh.
He was a natural audience. If you told a joke, he would get down on his knees and pound the floor. Just pound it, screaming with laughter. And sometimes he'd fall over. I mean, he'd laugh so hard he'd collapse on the floor. And when you say Jack Benny was on the floor laughing, he was, literally. Especially with George Burns, you know.
Tell you a funny story about Jack. Years ago, Mary and Jack, and Gracie and myself, we went to Louis B. Mayer's house, and he gave a dinner for Jeanette McDonald. And after dinner, Jeanette McDonald got up to sing Indian Love Call. And I leaned over to Jack, and I said, Jack, when this charming lady sings, if you was just to laugh, be very rude, said, don't do it. That's all I said. The minute she sang the first note, he fell on the floor. They carried him out of the room. He ruined the party. But see, I wasn't the only one that made him laugh. Jeanette McDonald made him laugh, too. Well, Indian Love Call is a very funny song.
He had, as you know, a strange sense of humor about his life. He loved to take auto trips with his banjo player, Frankie Remley. And Frankie would drive the car up, Jack would send his clothes, luggage out, and then Remley would say, where do you want to go? And Jack would say, which way is your car facing? And they would get in, and that's the direction in which he would go. The man behind the image was an absolute doll, as Mary called him.
He and Mary were so close and so sweet together. She had this beautiful diamond ring. I've never seen anything like it since or before. And she had this ring. Somebody stole this ring. And when we got to the plaza,
I got there the next day, and Mary was in tears and very upset. And she said, when I was there, she said, well, I have to tell Jay. I just have to call and tell Jack. I just have to. And so she called him, and she said, Jack, and she told him what happened. And he said, well, doll, it's like riding a horse. You just have to go into Winston and get another one. Otherwise, you'll be afraid the rest of your life with yourself.
Jack was always ready to donate his time to benefit servicemen overseas.
Jack did a lot of entertaining all around the world, you know. He went to the South Pacific before I did. I think he went to Europe before I did. But he was a biggie. And, of course, the great thing about it, everybody knew him because he'd been in show business for so damn long. And the kids that's the ones they want to see, the people they know that they've seen in movies and radio.
What do you want to hear? Huh? What is that, the bumblebee? You couldn't have stayed home today. I mean, you had to be in the... 11 Bloom, please.
You know, another thing I couldn't stop? And I must say, I have to say really and truly that I dislike it, and that is my theme song, Love and Bloom.
You dislike it?
I dislike it. I don't dislike it as a song. Mm-hmm. I dislike it as a theme song for me, but I couldn't stop it. Now, I want you to hear the lyrics.
I'd love to hear them. I've never thought of them.
Love and Bloom, and I want to find out what that has to do with me.
What?
Now, listen to these words.
Would you like a little musical background or just without it?
Just listen to these words.
All right.
Can it be the trees that fill the breeze with rare and magic perfume?
I think
now,
that's
what the hell has that got to do with me?
My father treated people alike. He didn't rate people. If he was friendly with Harry Truman, friendly with the guitarist in his orchestra, it was the same to him. One time, I had just given birth to my older daughter. I was in the hospital, and I was in the maternity wing. My father called me. It was 6 o'clock at night. Joni, I did the dumbest thing. I said, what did you do that was so dumb, Daddy? He said, I came down to the hospital to visit a sick friend, and I forgot to come see you. I said, Daddy, that's not so dumb. I mean, I was way, you know, 2 miles away in the maternity pavilion, and I saw you yesterday. I'll be home from the hospital tomorrow. I'll see you tomorrow. Don't worry about it. Finally, he said, well, you know, Harry Truman and I came down to see Lou Wasserman, and you were with Harry Truman? And you forgot to come see me? Yes, that's dumb. I mean, but that was, it didn't occur to him that, you know, that I would have been thrilled out of my mind to meet Harry Truman. But, you know, it was just, he was a friend.
Jack was not what you'd call a sophisticated man. He was basically quite a simple man. He was almost completely devoid of ego. I don't think he saw himself as a comedian.
I think he was often said if he'd rather had his choice between being a great violinist or a great comedian, he always said he would have chosen to be a great violinist. He often also said, it's a good thing I didn't make that choice because I did become a good comedian. And the only way I can make money for charities and various things through my concerts is because I'm a figure of fun when I play the violin.
With his unconventional musical skills, Jack was able to raise millions of dollars to benefit symphony orchestras across the country.
I must tell you about my friend Isaac here, who is probably the closest friend I have in the field of music. So close that he insults me quite often. You know what he said to me? You won't believe this. He asked me one day, he said, Jack, would you please, he says, how would you like to give a concert in San Francisco where the orchestra needs the money badly? So I said to him, well, Isaac, San Francisco's your hometown. Why don't you give the concert? He says, Jack, fellas like us can only get $5.50 a ticket. You gotta be pretty bad to get $100 for this. And I actually do. You know, I give concerts, we get $100 a ticket. Now, let me tell you how they arrange those seats. The $5 seats are in front, right here. Then they have a little further back, the $25 seats, and about the middle house, the $50. And way in back, the last five rows are $100 a ticket. Now, if you'll pay $200 a ticket, you don't have to come in at all.
I never thought he was as bad as they said he was. And they always said that Mary used to couldn't stand because he would practice all the time. He really would.
He was a much, 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 much better comedian than he was a violin player.
Jack's legacy will be the kind of humor I don't know if we'll ever see again. There are very few people with that kind of quiet humor. I don't know if we sit still long enough to hear that kind of humor anymore. That's the sad part of it.
I think Jack lasted as long as he lasted, and he would still be lasting today if he were alive, I don't think, because he's funny. And it was a timeless kind of a funny. He reacted the way humans react. He didn't force anything.
Jack Benny died on December 26, 1974, at the age of 39.
He had a sweetness, a sweet, gentle presence about him. And that's what I miss most of all, apart from his talent, but I miss the man.
Sometimes I'm introduced as the comedian's comedian. That's because I make Jack Benny laugh. I make Jack Benny laugh. Jack Benny made the whole world laugh.
To this day, any thought I have of Jack, and I pictures around the house and think back on him often, I continue to say, you'll never meet another one like him, and you're mighty lucky to have met him at all.
He spent his life inviting us to laugh at his failings, and in so doing, Jack Benny allowed us to laugh at ourselves.
Good night, folks.